very much for inviting me and exploiting me. And a very busy, a good program, thanks to Pedro. Thank you for the two excellent introductions. In my professional life, which included both academic and political, I've been dealing with monetary policy, fiscal policy, but most time and education I have spent on institutions and changes meaning reforms. And I think analytical, empirically based institutional economics is the most important subject. In economic sciences, even more broadly, and it's still evolving. It's not like anatomy. I think there are four basic issues. First, definition of the basic variables and measurement. And we can do it thanks to many new indices of institutional variables. Second is a question of cohesion, meaning what combination of various institutional arrangements in different spheres of life can coexist, regardless of performance. Third, and probably most importantly, it's a link between changes or differences in institutions and various dimensions of life, not only economic, but of course, for example, the extent of fear strongly depends on the institutional regime. And the fourth, which I'm going to focus very briefly, with the bird's eye are the dynamics of institutions and institutional systems, which is more speculative. Now, I cannot omit some brief definitions without boring you. Let me see on the first point that one issue which is under research is the importance of informal institutions, like mafias, for example. Well, the question is why ostensibly Greek formal institutions are not bad, but Greece is performing very badly since a certain time. And probably performs because of some bad informal institutions. Now, I think it's useful to distinguish between the content of rules or institutions and the level of enforcement. For example, under Soviet Constitution, there were some beautiful rules, but everybody knew that they were not enforced. It was very risky to demand. On the other hand, there were certain institutions like prohibition in the United States, which was not enforceable. So there are two dimensions. And for example, property rights, private property rights are very important, you know it, but the differences in the level of enforcement are very important for economic performance, especially if enforcement is very unequal, which is called oligarchic capitalism. So those who are linked to the political politicians enjoy very high level of protection, and the remaining businessmen are discriminated against. Finally, what matters, I've been interested, like many people, not in a single institution, but in the institutional system. And then the question is, what combination of institutions, say, in the country level, can make a system, by definition, can last, regardless of performance? And basically, we have two types of systems. There are many more, but two types. Those who perform very badly, and you know socialists were like that, but lasted. Why? Because of fear and intimidation. Whenever a system performs very badly, it can be maintained only because of fear, ultimately. And those regimes, which are not based on fear, but on the rule of law and extensive freedoms, but maybe undermined from within. Why? Because capitalism can be easily criticized within the capitalistic societies, and you may be very popular by writing and selling anti-capitalistic books. So one has to defend freedom even within the framework of the free regime. Okay. This is about what combinations of various institutional arrangements can last and why. And for example, socialists could not have been democratic. And then coming to that, if you use these words properly. And one important, and this is the second point, what are the institutional impossibilities? Like, for example, democratic socialism is like vegetarian hyena. More or less. Why socialism, in a sense of central grant economy, required a massive bureaucracy and monopolies? This was an institutional necessity. As I said, the most important point was about the link between changes in institutional system or differences and economic performance, which goes beyond economic dimension, even though economic dimension is very important. And the last initial explanation is between the link between institutional system and policies. They are pretty often confused. Now, I would propose that we should distinguish between two types of policies. The one which consists in changing institutions, and we call them reforms. Both the one that tried to do reforms, and they are very important if they go in the right direction. And those like monetary policy, which operate through important economic variables, like monetary. And there is a link between type of a system and institution that is this. A very important institutional variable, probably the most important, is the concentration of political power, which inversely related to the division of political power. And if you have a very heavy concentration of political power, which is called dictatorship, no checks and balances, no division of labor, you have worse crisis. There is anti-capitalistic propaganda which blames crisis on deficiencies of markets. But if you look at history and the research, the worst crisis in the sense of a collapse in the economy happened because of wrong, catastrophic, anti-human policies. Mao Zedong, 80%, 70 million people dead in the collapse, Stalin, etc. And blaming capitalists for the crisis results from the lack of comparative perspective. And it's extremely important to have comparative perspective. Now, and finally, remark then, through what ways or mechanism an institutional system affect the behavior of the people, and via behavior of the people, the conditions of life. First, very important, how broad is opportunity set or extent of freedom. But secondly, what are the risks of very bad policies? And the worst policies under democracy are much better than the worst policies under dictatorship. So Iran has to compare. So the best insurance against best policy is to get rid of dictators, which is sometimes pretty difficult, but very, very, very important. Now let me turn to the main problem which I would like to discuss very briefly. The changes, dynamics. Dynamics may include more change. And I start with something which is usually called stylized facts. Two opposite systems, maybe called on the one hand, very decentralized, lots of freedom without the rule of law. And the contrast is highly centralized, and the empirical approximation would be socialist, which I come into that. Now, they have different dynamics. With a decentralized system, you have a lot of bottom-up innovations, not only technological, but also business model, NGOs, etc., that are changing. So you don't have centralization of decision-making affecting institutions. And this makes for the flexibility of the system. So today's capitalism is very different from the one that existed 100 years ago, mostly because of this bottom-up. Many, many innovators. And this includes technical change, which has some social consequences. We are living through a revolution in human interactions, largely because of what? Of internet platforms. And this changes for good or bad, but it changes. Now, in a In centralized system, there's a centralization of decision making at the top, so the room for bottom-up innovations is very limited. And this is why the system is very rigid. So it cannot adapt to new technologies and new circumstances, but it can be maintained for many, many years because of intimidation. And we lived under such a system. And you know, it's impossible to forecast when a bad system ends. Who has forecasted the end of the former Soviet Union? It was impossible. Who has forecasted that there wasn't be a general secretary of the Soviet Communist Party who would dissolve the Soviet Communist Party? Gorbachev. It's impossible. It went beyond wildest imagination. But fortunately, it happened. So, what did I do? Oh, okay. Sorry. What should I... This? Okay. So, systems can persist largely regardless of their performance. Because bad systems can persist because of intimidation. And this is one important suggestion from that. If you see that there is a beginning of a system which could be, which can continue because of intimidation, you have to be very fast. Try to stop it. I call it bad transition. I come to this later. And to finish this very brief discussion of centralized bad systems, I would pose a question to which I do not have an answer. But if you look historically at Soviet socialism and Chinese socialism, you notice that Chinese socialism ended with the death of a despot, Mao Zedong. And then in the late 70s, Chinese so-called communists started market reforms. And these reforms were not gradual, as often said, they were quite radical because they started with dissolving the nonsensical Maoist communists. And agriculture then employed most of the population. But if you look at the former Soviet Union, they continued with an aiding system until Gorbachev, who wanted to improve it, dissolved it. Without his intention. So the historical question is, why Chinese communists were faster in market reforms than the Soviet socialism, so the communists, etc. And this is for the historian to answer. Now, so highly centralized system performs very badly, but it can continue because of fear. And what is the most characteristic institution under communism or socialism? Machinery of intimidation, which in Russia was called KGB and had different names in different countries, but basically the same function. What about highly decentralized system, which compared to highly centralized produces good economic outcomes and people are not afraid of its own state? You tend to naively to think that such a system which produces relatively good performance would continue without any problem. But this is not true. Why? Not because of external pressure, but because of a certain tendencies in the interest groups in every free system to which I return. So the paradox, perhaps, or seeming paradox is bad system can persist, even though they are bad. A good system can be undermined. So within the conclusion of process, you have to defend good systems against internal critics or enemies. So most of them hate capitalism while they prefer to live under capitalism. They do not go to Cuba to live there. Even Oliver Stone, Hollywood hater of capitalism, is not settling down in Cuba or Nicaragua, and our haters of capitalists are not settling down in Belarus. Because it's very lucrative to be a famous critic of capitalism while continuing living under capitalism. It's not that lucrative to be critic of socialism while living under socialism. There has been a very big aspect. Now, let me go down to less abstract. I find it useful to distinguish various institutional systems by at least four dimensions. And they are four, first important, and secondly, they can be measured. We have the measures. And based on these four or five dimensions, one can distinguish various institutional systems. Some of them I have shown here. The first dimension is democracy. I know it's 100 definitions of democracy, but one sense of it is, like Schumpeter has defined this, is an open, systematic political competition. Political competition exists in every system, but in democracy it's open and it's expressed through free elections. But to have democracy, you have to have extensive civil rights, because otherwise people cannot compete. If they are prohibited from organizing, if free speech is curtailed, etc. Civil rights have other purposes too, to be sure, to front the lobbies. But they are indispensable to have democracy. But not only that, rule of law. Of course, I have 100 definitions, but it's enough to say that under the rule of law, nobody can be imprisoned by the ruling politicians without the honest trial. And if your rule of law is violated, you have elections without choice. Look at Putin in Russia. People say he has won elections. What elections? There was no competition. Because his main rival was in prison, Navalny. So you see that rule of law is very important also for maintaining democracy. But of course it's important for quality of life for ordinary people, and without the rule of law you can't have much private investment because there's too much political uncertainty. And finally, economic freedom, which is often underestimated by non-economists, but crucially important. High level of the rule of law exists when you have private entrepreneurship without pernicious regulation. And when we have market interactions and not central planning. And we know from massive empirical research that economic freedom is indispensable for economic growth. Taking away economic freedom takes away economic growth in the long run. And secondly, democracy cannot exist without economic freedom. Why? Two reasons. If everybody is state-controlled, everybody can be dismissed. And you can't have opposition. And secondly, if you have a fully controlled economy, which is called socialism, it tends to perform very badly. So how can you maintain it? By taking away civil freedoms and the rule of law. In other words, you have to frighten the people. And this is the definition of what is called socialism, which we live through. I mean, older generation, not the ladies. And we know beyond any doubt that it was a very bad system, both on all counts, economy, extent of fear, possibilities of self-realization, and huge inequalities in power. People mostly focus on inequalities in wealth, but inequalities in power. And you can kill, you can imprison anybody, even worse, not much worse. Okay, so this was the bad system, and the fact that it disappeared, at least initially, was the best transformation after the Second World War. And if you speak, how can we define whether transformation is good or bad? By looking what is happening to civil rights, rule of law, economic freedom, and as a result, democracy. That's more or less objective. And if some of these dimensions being lowered without the benefit of increases in other dimensions, then you can say it's about transformation. And if you have a decline on all counts, like in some countries, which I'm going to discuss in a bit, you have certainly a very good transformation. Yeah. And the transformation away from socialism increased civil rights, rule of law, economic freedom, and as a result, democracy. In this sense, it was a good transformation. Now perhaps many people are surprised that most of Arab or Islamic countries perform very bad economically, and sometimes they blame this on Islam, I think wrongly. The true cause is that they are quasi-socialist. So we have a dominance of the state sector in the economy, a little less than in classical socialist, but quite heavy. Saudi Arabia is socialist, economically speaking, even though there is a king in the role of first secretary. Iran is a larger socialist. Iraq was a larger socialist, etc. And it's not surprising they are performing very badly. And very briefly, there are various kinds of what is called capitalism. And the sensitive discussions should focus on which kind is the best. And again, we have a lot of research. A lot of research shows that something which I am calling here free market capitalism, which assumes the rule of law, free markets are not anarchic. So rule of law, free market, extensive economic freedom ensures the best economic growth and if there's a fiscal discipline, stability. And there may be a paradox. Nowadays Sweden may be closer to free market than the United States because it's less regulation, a bit higher social spending, but it's not true that you don't have social spending in the United States. You have this more social spending as a percentage of GDP in the United States than in Canada or Switzerland. A bad kind of capitalism is called crony capitalism. You have a nominal, you have private ownership, it's a legal category, but there are people who are privileged because of its ties to the president or the maybe president themselves. And this is a bad system because it's both unfair and it's inefficient. We have very unequal protection of property rights, which reduces competition. And finally, a mixed bag. Most of present Western countries fall in the category of overregulated, and some of them fiscally fragile economies, certainly Italy, to some extent France. This is not because of external influences. It's not because of European Union. It's because of internal domestic dynamics. And I can say briefly that there are no European solutions for Italian problems. There are Italian solutions for the Italian problems. It's very important for Italians, not only the Italians, whether they would introduce these solutions for their problems. Okay, now let me move again with two kinds of this brief discussion of institutional dynamics under two different systems. And the initial liberal system, which is more or less close to what I describe as a free market regime with democracy, and the seeming puzzle is why such a systems are not necessarily lasting. Why in most countries there is accumulation of regulation, even in the United States. Now, you cannot explain this without analyzing the display of interest groups, which may influence political parties. So the theory of interest groups is indispensable for explaining the internal dynamics, erosion, or danger of the erosion of economic freedom, and not there are some other variables, types of economic situation too, which I'll be coming in a minute. But speaking about interest groups, is given this. I think the greatest theorist, analyst of interest groups was Martin Olson, a great American economist, sociologist, And he made some genuine discoveries. For example, he pointed out that small interest groups may be more effective than large interest groups, because small interest groups have more to win, for the member, etc., etc. And he then developed a theory whereby, for example, lost wars may have a beneficial impact upon economic growth, because if they destroy the inherited interest groups which narrow down economic freedom. It's still a contested theory, but there's something in it. What I'm going to do here, I would like to add something very, very briefly. And these are, I think, topics for research. Now, also focus on interest groups with a strong pecuniary motivation, financial gains. So if you get extra regulatory privileges, you get some gains. You can charge higher prices. Or you may have the same income with less effort. And they are very important. And notice that interest groups with pecuniary motivation may be strong, but defenders of freedom are not guided by pecuniary motivation. Defenders of freedom, classical liberals, etc., want to have not privileges, but less privileges of other people. And this is one of the reasons they have to work harder. They have to be more idealistic, because they cannot rely on strong financial incentives. So it is more important they have sponsors. And the liberal things just rely on sponsors, because they are not guided by pecuniary motivation. The second point is that what is probably underestimated is the power of interest groups who are guided by anti-capitalistic ideological motives. Inequality. All of a sudden has been an explosion of discussions about inequalities without distinguishing inequality of situation and income and inequality of opportunity. I just read that in New York Times during a few last years, the number of articles about inequality has increased 8 times. So which influenced public opinion and may to some extent explain why during last elections we have two collectivists launched, Sanders in the United States and Mr. Trump. That's the intellectual climate. So it's what is needed empirically is to investigate the power of anti-market ideological groups. And some of radical ecologists, I'm not saying all ecologists belong to this category, they can be quite influential, because many people just want to save the world by restricting economic freedom. They are not necessarily right. Now let me briefly focus on another variable, which is what type of economic situation is good for free market reforms or is bad for free market reforms. These are just observations. I'm not developing a complex theory. So take improving economic situation. If economic situation improves because of previous reforms, you would tend to think, perhaps naively, that the fact that previous reforms tended to improve the situation, then people should defend these reforms as bringing improvement. But this is not necessarily the case. Why? Because first, one reason is improving economic situation brings about more funds to be distributed by the budget. Secondly, there is generation change. People forgot. So from generation to generation, there's not necessarily a lasting. And finally, so good results of good economic reforms are not sufficient to defend these reforms under the free markets or freedom regimes. The conclusion, an obvious one, freedoms, including special economic freedom, has to be defended. Even if you can show that lack of freedom is much worse. Because people, some people are not immune to this kind of argumentation. So, it much worse it is the situation when improving economic situation is due to windfall gains, like in Argentina on the populace. They were benefiting from the growing prices of the export products, and then many people were convinced that populist policies are very good, because the economic situation has been improving. So the work of liberal groups is even more important for the such a situation. Okay, what about crisis? We tend to think that economic crisis is bad, but at least it forces policymakers to do these reforms. And this is largely true, but not 100% true. It was true in the case of Poland in 89, because people, first they realized that the previous system was very bad, and secondly they realized that we had a crisis, so it was not much need to convince people to move forward. The point was to move forward faster. So in the first 2 years I did not engage very much in communication, it would be a waste of time, very much. I spent most of time in trying to elaborate and move forward with radical reforms. But it is not always the case. Take Argentina as an example. Very deep crisis in the year 2000. And most of the people were convinced that the crisis was due to the previous reforms. Why? Because there were some general reforms like privatization, deregulation, but reforms were not complete. And mechanisms of fiscal irresponsibility at the level of provinces were in part. On top of that, we had some external shocks. And there was a collapse. Majority of people were convinced that this was because of previous reforms and voted for the populists. And populists were very lucky, because when they started to govern, then there was a boom. Windfall gains. So it's very bad for a country when bad guys have good luck. But you cannot control this combination. So it happens. It happens and you have to fight the consequences. But the point I wanted to make in general observation is you have to try to win the interpretation of the crisis, root causes of the crisis. Because if under democracy it's a public opinion which ultimately influences politics, and if public opinion is convinced that crisis is due to some excesses of free markets, they would vote against. They will like the widespread lesson about the reasons of the recent financial crisis, which blames the market, etc., instead of blaming bad policies. There are many bad policies which contribute to the recent fiscal crisis, and this popular interpretation, I think, was one of the reasons. Class inequality propaganda was one of the reasons for the strengthening of the recent wave of anti-free market opinions and sentiments in some countries. So again, skillful communication activists of free market or liberal groups is very important. Now, let me finish with something which I skipped. I skipped it too, you can read it. Now, I'd like to focus on something which I call bad transition after free elections. And I am not referring to the interwar period, Mussolini, Hitler, etc., but to what is happening during the last 15 or 20 years. First of all, what cases of bad transition? When I say bad transition, I mean that changes lower, rule of law, civil rights, and consequently the level of democracy. This is it. And I think there are three cases of so-defined bad transitions. Transitions which are already completed. Lukashenko in Belarus, Putin in Russia, and we are going to see what about Turkey under Erdogan. By completed, I mean it's impossible to win elections, because there are no free elections. you have no competition, or very limited competition. And then it's like under dictatorship, you text what is going to happen in this black box of the clique. And it's impossible to foresee. Impossible. The second type is bad transitions which started and not yet completed. This is Poland, which starts in 2015, sorry. I'm ready to respond to your observations and questions. Hungary, according to Kornai, is already a completed bad transition. It may be disputed, but completed means you cannot win elections, because competition is eliminated or very much limited. And finally, an interesting category which I am observing are bad transitions which have been democratically reversed. And so far I found in Macedonia, and perhaps it may sound very exotic, Sri Lanka. But I'm still doing the research. So this is the categorization. Now, there have been many comparative studies of the recent debt transition, but I noticed that there are too many easy generalizations. You know, to say Trump on the one hand and Orban or Putin is too much generalization. There are different reasons and different phenomena. So I find it useful to distinguish two questions. First, what factors are explained empirically, the victory of a group which started the transition? And you have different combination of factors. One cannot just sum up into one factor, say populism, because it's just a name, not an explanation. Okay, we cannot say it is because of social media, it may contribute, but cannot explain fully. And second, what happens next? Meaning, how long is that transition is going to last? Is it going to end in a Russian situation, or is it going to be democratically elected? This is the basic question for dynamics. And let me illustrate the first case. The first question, answer the first question with the Polish example of 2015. We had first presidential elections in May, and then we had parliamentary elections, I think in October. And completely unexpectedly, the previous president, who was a decent guy, really has lost. Even though he initially had 70% popularity rate, and he lost to the present president, who initially had 3%. Why? Because of huge differences in election campaign. So the previous president has a very bad election campaign, almost nothing. And the winner has very bad promises and very skillful manipulative campaign. So campaign better, very, very much. You have to be, it's not enough as we know to have a good program. You have to be very skillful. We don't know still whether Cambridge Analytica was involved in Poland or not. We cannot rule it out, but even without knowing that, you know, there are huge difference in the quality of campaign. So, and then parliamentary elections, which have some chance factors. Remember in history, what happens does not need to happen. There are shocks. Political shocks, accidents, not only in construction industry, but in politics. What were the shocks in Poland? Well, first, errors of the previous party, the civic platform, which consisted of my younger colleagues. They did some things which had antagonized part of electorate. They nationalized pension funds. And there was so much against, you know, the essence of their program that many people very indignant. I was very active in opposing this. Some people blame me for the button wrongly. And there was a first. Second one, there was a certain momentum. Unexpectedly, the president from the present ruling party as well, and it encouraged the momentum of parliamentary elections, but there is some other factors. They were extremely dark. Two parties missed threshold, very few votes. And there was also the situation where the question of the refugees erupted and was used or misused in an extremely demagogic way. Extremely demagogic. It continued. What is demagogy? Saying or implying that refugees are terrorists. I guess you know it. This is immoral. In a very Catholic country, and in Poland. Alright, so all of a sudden we landed in a scenario nobody had foreseen mostly, that all the centers of power are fighting the same target, because the president cannot be in Poland considered to be independent from the party. And the implementation using of this situation went widely beyond expectations and widely beyond the program of the peace, justice, etc. party, because they never said that they were going to attack the independence of the judges and take over the prosecution and take over in a shameless way the public media. Unprecedented shameless ways. Well, but we're again lucky because the economy has been booming. And under the booming economy, only few people care about non-economic issues. It's growing, the proportion is growing. But, so I'm describing just one case which I know the best. And the main point is that you have different combination of reasons why. There's a beginning of a better transition. But what is common is that those people who want to introduce that transition, they are using three mechanisms or instrumental tools everywhere. First, it is bribing. Or not necessarily according to a legal sense, clientelism. So distributing money to create or strengthen the support and distributing jobs. Secondly, is propaganda or indoctrination. And third is selective intimidation. And the third tool is the ultimate one, because if you have a strong intimidation tools, you can survive like under socialism. Or look at Venezuela. It's an economic catastrophe in Venezuela, but still Maduro survives. Why? Because he relies on intimidation. So it's very important practical point is try to stop intimidation by monitoring those who would try to intimidate individual prosecutors. So not everybody should be known. Not anonymity. Anonymity is a protection. Now, so these are these three instruments. In Poland, I think the first tool, which means writing, has been exhausted in a sense. We cannot go more. Or they cannot go more because the budget deficit is being the budget has been stretched. And if growth slows down, then the fiscal spending would bear negative signals, and the amount of job distribution has been unprecedented. Everything which is can be under control of the ruling party has been. We have massive purges in the public administration, in public TV, in public media, and the state-controlled firms. Unprecedented in Polish history after 89. So this is exhausted. So it's the last tool. And the most important point is to neutralize this tool, which by activity of civil society, which is developing in Poland, And I think we have a very much larger chances to succeed than Hamdallah's encounter. But you should never assume the success, you should work to the success. Thank you very much. So the last point, what is striking is that these bad transitions for the rule of law, civil rights, are also bad for the economy. So it's not like, say, in Chile. There was a suspension of civil rights democracy, but explosion of free market reforms. The lowering of economic freedom, and it is important, but also a very organized thing. Okay.